Salam alaikum. Nailo Aljalia Al-Hindia Saidun Bel Hedifal Beyu Al-Estiklal Fi Al-Mamlaka Al-Arabia Al-Saudia. We the Indian communities present here are honored to celebrate the 68th Indian Independence Day in the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia. With the Kingdom, we have always shared a very strong relation since the history dating year 980 in field of commerce, trade and mutual defense. In the recent years, India and Saudi Arabia developed a bilateral ties in space research, nuclear science studies, education, car manufacturing, commerce and many more. India was a nation in the whole world, but with centuries of invasions and attacks on India, we were affected. Since 1947, after independence, in the past 68 years, we started to develop again. We made great progress in every field within a very, very short time, and we all are proud of it. We are multicultural, most diverse society.
You also group, our president is Indian, so always helps as well. Thank you on behalf of the entire executive team for all of your continued hard work. We are very, very much appreciative of what you do, and we are very proud to have you all here. Enjoy your National Day. Congratulations.
Now, I would like to request our Director of Human Resources, Mr. Madhana Mohamed, to come and grace the occasion with his words.
India's Space Agency will launch a spacecraft designed as gone to date. We're talking about Mars, and if they are successful, it will be a technological leap that will propel India ahead of space rivals China and Japan in the field of interplanetary exploration. A particular mission has cost India around $73 million. Now, in context, that's relatively a small amount. For example, in the States, it would spend 10 times as much on a similar mission.
They've been very clever about their investment. You always have to have the next target. They've always been trying to get ahead of the game, and now they're doing it. They're actually doing their own thing. They went to the moon in 2008. So where next? Mars has to be it.
The United States imports oil from Saudi Arabia, cars from Japan, TVs from Korea, and whiskey from Scotland. So what do we import from India? We import people, really smart people. And as you're about to see, the smartest, most successful, most influential Indians who've migrated to the U.S. seem to share a common credential. They're graduates of the Indian Institute of Technology, better known as IIT. IIT may be the most important university you've never heard of. Put Harvard, MIT, and Princeton together, and you begin to get an idea of the status of this school in India.
And then you plug this back in, and you...
With a curriculum that may be the most rigorous in the world.
The IITs probably are the hardest school in the world to get into.
The whole world. Vinod Khosla got into IIT about 30 years ago, co-founded Sun Microsystems. The head of the giant consulting firm McKinsey & Company is an IIT grad. So is the vice chairman of Citigroup and the former CEO of US Airways. Fortune 500 headhunters are always on the lookout for that IIT degree.
They are favored over almost anybody else. If you're a WASP walking in for a job, you wouldn't have as much pre-assigned credibility as you do if you're an engineer from IIT.
hotel business at Israta Aurora, president of Rosewood Hotels and Resorts.
I mean, as Simon pointed out, our booking pace is 12% higher than last year.
Rajiv Suri is now the chief executive of Nokia.
The latest in a list which includes PepsiCo's Indra Nui, MasterCard boss Ajay Banga, Anshu Jain, the co-chief executive of Deutsche Bank, and Shantanu Narayan of Adobe. So might someone growing up in India have qualities that makes them stand out on the world stage?
They are able to relate to different cultures, frankly, sometimes different religions. So I think that diversity plays a very critical role.
You know, this business of ours is an exciting business. And one of the core things that we've got to realize is that this business does not really respect tradition. What it respects is innovation on a go-forward basis. So it's really our collective challenge that we now need to make Microsoft thrive in a mobile-first and a cloud-first world.